And welcome to Zoom with Czarny. Today is Thursday, April 1st. And I am honored to have as my guest, Judge Erica Clarke. She's the newest judge for City Court, and she's running for a 10-year term. She was appointed by Mayor Walsh in January as Judge McMahon left the City Court to go to the Supreme Court after a successful run last year. And when a judge is appointed in New York law, they run for a full 10-year term. So she's not taking on the vacancy, as we would say, with another office. She's going to be running for a full 10-year term. And I really had a good conversation with her. It's hard to talk to judges on this program, mainly because they can't say much. They can't take positions on any issue, really. And, you know, because they have to reserve their biases for the courtroom and cannot, show any bias towards any particular position. They have to weigh each case as it comes before them. But we talk about her background, what it's like to be running for office in COVID. And this is really what I'm going to be moving Zoom with Czarny to over the next few months. You're going to see a lot more candidate interviews and a lot less of, democracy advocates like I've been doing over the last few months, because we are, getting into the thick of it here. We have 17 county legislative seats and 19 different towns, and the city of Syracuse are all running candidates, and that's a lot of interviews to do between now and November. So I'm going to be start getting into that over the next month or so, and really in May and June, I'll really be into almost solely interviews with candidates. And then sometime in, probably September, to be able to get all these candidates done before November, I'll probably be going to 2 episodes a week on Thursdays and Sundays. But for now, we're going to stay with the single format and then, amplify it later on when the election season is underway. Today is April 1st. It's April Fool's Day. It's one of the jokes I used to have is that this is when we would find out who's really running for office or not. Well, that really kind of came a couple weeks ago because of the shortened petition season. But what we are seeing now is some, resignations and people being substituted in some of the town races, and objections are coming in. We don't have a lot of objections so far this year. There's only a few. We'll see if they turn into specific objections, and then the board will have to decide whether we're throwing candidates off the ballot or not. It's not something that we like to do. It's not something that it's easy to do. You have to really have not done your work as a candidate to do to get good signatures. It's very hard to throw somebody off nowadays. So, but we'll see how that works out over the next couple of weeks. And then, of course, by the end of April, we'll know exactly what the primaries are this year and most of the candidates, although many of the Democratic towns are still putting their candidates on the ballot through their caucus system. So I'll keep you up to date on that as those notices come in as well. So now I'm just going to turn this over to my interview with Judge Erica Clarke, Fowler grad, Syracuse City grad, and our candidate on the Democratic ballot for this November. I'm happy to bring this interview to you. Thank you. And we're back. I'm very pleased to have as my next guest, Judge Erica Clarke. She's Syracuse's newest city court judge, having been appointed in January. And we'll be running for a full 10-year term this November. Erica, thanks for joining me on Zoom with Czarny.
Oh, thank you for having me, Dustin. It's great to be here.
So as I remind my viewers who saw me do these judge interviews over the last couple of years, it's really hard to do judge interviews, right? I mean, like you can't.
Yeah.
Judicial ethics prevent you from taking hard positions on topics. And so, with that be in mind, I'd like to just talk to you about you. Erica, tell us a little bit about your background.
Well, this is probably This is a dream come true for me, especially considering my background. A lot of people know that I was a teen parent. My mother was also a teen parent. So my mom was actually a grandmother, I think at 32 or 33, if my math serves me correctly. She had me at 15. I had my son at 18. At that point, I put myself through law school. I put myself through college while working full time as an adult. I ended up at the DA's office. I worked there I started in 2009 as an intern in the appeals unit. I was then hired on. I was there until 2017, prosecuting all types of different cases, misdemeanor level, felony level, DWI, vehicular crimes. Then I went to Syracuse City Corporation Council. I was there for 2 years. And during that 2 year time that I was there, I ended up having my own practice doing criminal defense work. And we were allowed to do that on the side. And I was doing that and I loved it so much that I wanted to jump into that full time, which is what I did. So I opened my own practice and specializing pretty much solely in criminal defense. I really don't think I really did much of anything else. Mostly assigned counsel work, so mostly indigent clients. I did do some retained work, but I really loved working with the panel and assigned counsel program. So I did that for quite a while. I was elected to their board of directors. And when this came up, I really didn't know that this was going to happen the way it did. And I was actually encouraged by other attorneys and other colleagues that told me, you know, you're the perfect candidate for this. Put your name in. And I didn't think it could happen. I mean, I am from Syracuse. I went to city schools for most of my schooling. I went to Danforth Elementary. I went to Clary Middle School for a time, and I went to Fowler High School. I was on my own at a very young age and started working fast food jobs and ended up quitting school, got my GED. And that's when, you know, all of this started. And to have this background and have the confidence to do this, I think a lot of people helped me with that. And this is the way it worked out. And it's been amazing.
So, yeah, you're a Syracuse native, you know, and came up through Syracuse City Schools. You know, I'm sure that has colored your experience in coming to the bench. What are the areas that you're hoping to work on in city court, or what are you working on now? You've been appointed since January. What city court does so many different things. What are you assigned to right
now? Right now, I just finished a landlord-tenant rotation, which was really different for me because it's something I've never done. I've been a prosecutor, I've been a defense attorney, I've been a municipal attorney, but never done landlord-tenant work. So that was something new. Something interesting that I never even expected to do. So I'm learning that as I go. I'm doing that. And because of COVID, there's a lot of extra rules with regard to the landlord-tenant cases. So now I'm doing hearings, which are essentially pretty short to determine whether we can enter certain judgments. And so I think all of us on the bench are learning this as we go. So it was actually a good time to come in because all of us are learning together. I have a criminal court calendar, obviously, every afternoon on the weeks that I'm on. Because of COVID, they do a 2 week on, 2 week off rotation. And this next 2 weeks, I'm doing more landlord-tenant hearings. And then after that, starting, I believe, the 12th, I'll be going into arraignments, which I'm really excited for because I'm so used to doing them for the past decade or so.
So we mentioned kind of that you've been there since January, but your route to getting to the bench is not normal. I mean, even we had a vacancy occur because Judge McMahon ascended to the Supreme Court after winning a successful election last year. And so that created an opening. And that's unusual as in and of itself. But you also had our first and only independent mayor in the city of Syracuse. And it was his only appointment to the bench in his first term. And he chose you, but yet you still had to go to the Democratic Party, which is putting somebody else up for mayor. So what was that process like? And this is your first time running for office. So you had to do all of that in the first time. What was that like?
Yeah, I'm definitely never been involved in politics. Nobody in my family has been involved in politics or knows anything about politics. So this was all uncharted territory for me. So getting appointed by Mayor Walsh was sheerly on the merits. I didn't know him. I had met him, obviously, working in Corp Council, but he did not know me. I didn't know him. We've met a few times in passing, but there was no like friendship between he and I. He interviewed, I believe there was six of us, and he ended up choosing me based on, you know, from what I've been told, my life experience, as well as my legal experience. So being appointed, I thought, okay, you know, now I'll just seek the nomination, but I didn't realize how much of a difference there was going to be in seeking a nomination when I'd had a different party mayor appointed me. But I was able to navigate that, and everybody's been, you know, really wonderful to me. I sought the Democratic designation because obviously I am a Democrat. I've always been a Democrat. And, you know, I introduced myself to everyone. I put the work in, I made the phone calls, I talked to everybody. It was a great experience, and I was lucky enough to win the designation. And I really put my heart into that. And I really wanted it. And I really think I earned it.
So you talked earlier about being a teen mom. I was a teen dad. I had my daughter at 17. And so I empathize with you there. But people, I don't think, realize how much that changes you as a person. And you know, you don't get those 4 years at college. You don't get those, you know, I mean, obviously you put yourself through college, but you did it a different way. What do you think that brings to the bench?
Well, being that I did everything backwards, it gives me different perspective. I think that most of my colleagues were able to do it the traditional way. And a lot of the people that come before me, I think, are probably going to be people like me who are doing it backwards or who want to do it backwards, but just don't know how or don't have the resources. And I was that person. Thankfully, I had a couple of people in my life, mothers of my best friends that really assisted me and influenced me and showed me how to do certain things and go to college and apply for this and apply for that, because that was something that was foreign in our family. So having that perspective and to be able to show people that know my story and know, you know, what background I have, and I've made it to the bench through hard work and perseverance, I really think it matters. And my Facebook page was a testament to that, because so many people, when we posted, when my campaign manager posted my bus passes, I mean, the response was overwhelming. And that felt so good to me to see that I was an inspiration to a lot of young women and frankly, young men who are coming from the same place or the same family background that I do.
As we, you know, get into the campaign, you mentioned that, you know, you did a shift in landlord tenant, which is, you know, an eye-opening experience. I actually, when I worked for Corporation Council, I wasn't a lawyer, but I was dealing with the landlord side of the collection of fees. And I did a lot of landlord tenant work, and how much things have changed because of COVID right now. But that's not going to just change the way you practice on the bench. That's going to change the way you campaign as well. How are you, you know, you do have a Republican opponent, you know, it's Democratic City, but no one takes anything lightly. How are you planning to campaign during, you know, what we still believe is going to be a COVID season of campaign?
Right. We're hoping that we can do some events in person. We're hoping that that's going to be the case as the weather gets warmer and hopefully the numbers go down and more people are vaccinated. That's what we're hoping for. In any event, we did a few, you know, during petitioning, we did go door to door a little bit. And people were hesitant with the door knocking because of COVID, but it still ended up working out. So I think that we can work within the parameters that we have. We can do virtual fundraisers, we could do virtual meet and greets, but I wholeheartedly would like to do everything in person so people can get to know me. But I understand if that's not possible, we will do whatever we have to do. We'll improvise. My campaign manager and I, we've discussed a lot of different avenues that we can take. Just basically getting the word out so people know who I am outside of the legal community, because most people in the legal community, they obviously know me. But other people, you know, they really don't, because I am a political newbie. So I want to make sure that I make my presence known, make who I am known, let people know what I stand for, you know, within the bounds of the judicial ethics, and go from there. So I think there's plenty of things that we can do once we brainstorm a little bit more and determine, okay, what can we do in person? How many people can we have? So there's it's a little more stringent, but I think we still got quite a bit to work with.
So as we take this interview, obviously, you know, there's a wave of social activism on, you know, social justice, police reform. We have the trial in Minnesota going on right now. Obviously, you can't take specific positions on any particular thing.
Right.
But it does, you know, the city court judgeship will deal with urban poor and minorities more than any other judge outside of maybe family court in our area. So, you know, how does your background bring you into that? How are you going to approach this portion of justice with these, you know, with this social interest out there on these other issues?
I think that my background lends itself to dealing with those things in a good manner. I'm very familiar with all types of people of all types of walks of life. I've been married, my husband, obviously, we've been together for 23 years. My son is biracial. You know, we've had to discuss a lot of things with him. My best friends, all of my friends are, you know, non-white. So I've had a ton of exposure, especially growing up mostly in the city. So I have a lot of exposure with different types of people and the issues of poverty, having come from a family there where many of them are still living in poverty. So I'm sensitive to all of those things because of my own background and my own experiences. So I think that I can have not just the empathy, but actual experience in dealing with all different types of people, all different types of problems, all different types of, you know, social issues. It's been something that I've been dealing with in my whole legal career, from being a prosecutor to a defense attorney, to even being a corporation counsel. So I think I'm well versed in dealing with all types of social issues, as I indicated.
So what am I not mentioning? What do you want the voters to know about you or about the position that I haven't been able to bring out here? What you tell me, you know, what else do we need to talk about when we're talking about this position?
Really, the main thing that I want people to know about me is that this is something that I can basically show the young people of our city that this is possible. Coming from where I come from, my family being not unconnected, non-political, having no means, financial means, and you can still do it. You can still, it's never too late. So you can have a child, you can get a GED, but that doesn't mean that you're stuck and you can't pursue anything further. So you can still go to college, you can still go to law school or medical school or whatever it is that you wanna do. So I think that for me, being you know, an example for other people and treating people the way that I would want to be treated is really what I want people to know, is that's what I intend to do. I'm not saying, oh, you know, everybody gets a slap on the wrist. Of course not. But at the same time, you have to know when to be punitive and when not to be punitive and when to be restorative and different approaches to being a judge. So I think with my background, it lends to that. So I think that's definitely something that I'm going to be employing on the bench, and something I do employ on the bench. Having the background as a prosecutor and a defense attorney, I think is super beneficial. And I have that background. So I want people to just know that I plan to apply the law in a fair way, in a just way. And obviously I can't use my life experience in interpreting the law, but I can use it to have empathy and to make decisions based on the law and what exactly is right.
Well, Eric, thank you, Judge Clarke. Thank you so much for coming on with Zoom with Czarny. I wish you very, incredible luck. It's going to be a hard campaign year. And I want to also thank you for putting your name forward. I don't think people realize how hard it is to run for office.
Yeah.
And to get out there. And I wanted to thank you for coming on and sharing, your personal side of this journey for you. And I wish you all the luck in this coming election season.
Thank you so much.
All right, and next week we'll be having on Zoom with Czarny Bridget Kenny. She's the spokesperson for Flip the Ledge and a group that is going to be putting out many different county legislator candidates to take the majority for the Democrats, hopefully this year. And we're going to do an overview of the 9 candidates that have been put forward to take the ledge. And also, of course, I just dropped yesterday my Wonky Wednesday with the town of Manlius. Check that out. It's on my Tumblr and Facebook feeds. Next week, we'll be doing the town of Marcellus. And I'll see you in Commissioners in the Car and Zoom with Czarny's and, Saturday, ask me anything you want. I'm trying to be here and help us navigate through the 2021 election season. Please remember that the virus is still out there. If you can get a shot, it's open up now to 30 plus. It'll be open up to 16 plus next week. Please get the vaccine. And if you can, please continue to wear a mask and social distance so we can all be together this summer and start to see maybe some normalcy in our lives again. Thank you very much. And enjoy. Bye-bye. We'll be singing when we're winning. We'll be singing. I get no-